Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this session on assisting developing and least developed countries on WTO law. My name is Niall Marr. I'm the executive director of an organization called the Advisory Center on WTO Law in Geneva, which we're going to talk about a little bit today and what our work is in terms of assisting developing countries on WTO law and how it can be that participating fully in the legal aspects of the WTO system can benefit developing and least developed countries. Before we start, I'd like to thank ICTSD for organizing this symposium. I know that Simon and Sophie and all our colleagues from ICTSD have put a lot of work into this event, and we very much appreciate that. We partner fairly often with ICTSD on various training activities and other joint programs, so it's very nice to have the opportunity to do so again here. It's also a pleasure to be, for my first time at least, in Nairobi. As we may discuss, Kenya was a founding member of the ACWL, and Amina Mohamed at the time was quite involved in setting up the ACWL and was a member for several years of our management board. So we're very happy to be here. Also, one of our panelists, Marianne Macheru, is a lawyer with the Kenyan government who spent a year, 2 years ago, working as a seconded lawyer in the ACWL. For this morning's panel, we'd like to make it as much as we can an interactive session discussing what the role of the legal aspects of the WTO system are and what burdens, challenges, and opportunities that provides for developing and least developed countries. Before we get to sort of the interactive part of the program, I'm going to explain a little bit how the need for the ACWL arose and how we try to fulfill that need. Then my colleague Jan Bohannes, who's senior counsel at the ACWL, will talk a little bit about developing country participation in the dispute settlement system and provide some background on the extent of developing country participation in the system. We're also very happy to have with us Ryan Jenner, who is the Deputy Permanent Representative of the Philippines at the WTO in Geneva. And Ryan has been involved in many legal issues in the WTO, including dispute settlement proceedings, both involving developed countries, but also involving other developing countries against the Philippines. And on occasion, we've been on the same side as Ryan in those disputes, but also we've been on opposite sides as Ryan in those disputes. So Ryan will give you that perspective. And then finally, as I mentioned, Marianne worked with us 2 years ago, and she's going to give us a few remarks about her time at the ACWL and how she benefited from that and her perspective on how developing countries such as Kenya can or should be involved in the legal aspects of the WTO system. To give you a little bit of background, when the GATT became the WTO, there were two major changes that affected the legal aspects of the system. First was just the increased complexity of the agreements. There were many more agreements, many more legal texts to be interpreted. Secondly, for the first time, there was binding dispute settlement. Under the GATT, dispute settlement was not binding. Members could either block the establishment of a panel to hear a dispute, or later on they could block the adoption of the report. So it was never truly binding. And so the GATT system never truly led to the establishment of legal norms that governed the relations of members in the GATT system. But that changed with the WTO. Now there was a binding dispute settlement system which very quickly became extremely heavily used and led to the creation of even more legal texts that had to be interpreted, that conditioned the interaction of members in the WTO system. Very quickly after the creation of the WTO, it became apparent that developing countries lacked the legal capacity to participate fully in this system. So by the late 1990s, there was a movement underway to provide developing countries with increased legal capacity so that they could not be disadvantaged by this system, so that if developed countries were to bring disputes against them, they would be able to defend themselves. So if other countries were negatively affecting developing countries' rights under the agreements, developing countries would be able to pursue disputes and defend their rights. And just by way of comparison, for example, in the European Commission in Brussels, they have 15 or 20 lawyers working more or less full time on WTO matters. So if anyone in the EU needed legal advice on WTO law, they could just go down in the hall and get it from these 15 or 20 lawyers. Same thing in Washington, in the Office of the United States Trade Representative. Same thing in Ottawa and Canberra and probably other developed capitals. Many developing countries, however, lack this kind of expertise and faced other barriers. Some developing countries had different legal traditions. There were language barriers. Getting materials translated into local languages was difficult. So there were lots of sort of administrative and capacity restraints facing developing countries in participating in this system. So in the late 90s, a group of both developed and developing countries decided to do something about this. They concluded that the WTO legal system would not have credibility if all members of the WTO weren't able to participate in that legal system on an equal footing. There was some provision for legal advice to be provided to developing countries by the WTO in the WTO dispute settlement rules, the understanding on dispute settlement. However, that was conditioned by the requirement that any such advice could not be given in a way that would jeopardize the impartiality of the WTO secretariat. So in considering how to provide a mechanism for developing countries to get more legal capacity, it was first considered to set up maybe an office within the WTO. But very quickly it was realized that that might place the secretariat in a position of conflict. If you had lawyers at one end of the WTO building advising developing countries in a dispute that was being adjudicated by lawyers at the other end of the corridor, there would be a potential for conflict. So it was decided to set up a separate independent organization. And that became, in 2001, the Advisory Center on WTO Law, the ACWL, which was set up as an international organization with a similar structure to the WTO. It was set up jointly by developed and developing countries. The developed countries, we have 11 developed country members, most of whom are smaller EU members. So my own native country, Ireland, Denmark, Sweden, Finland, Netherlands, Italy, United Kingdom, and then outside the EU, we have Canada, Australia, and Norway. And they've provided most of the funding for the organization. They're not entitled to any of our services. And we have a governance structure that's set up so that we're managed not by the members, but by an independent management board, which ensures the impartiality of our operations. We have currently 34 developing country members that have joined the organization that are entitled to the services. In addition, all of the least developed members of the WTO are automatically entitled to our services without having to join the organization. So we currently have 76 WTO members that are entitled to our services, which is approximately half, a little bit less than half of the membership of the WTO. We were set up with a mandate to provide three kinds of services. First is assistance in dispute settlement proceedings. So if developing countries want to bring a WTO dispute or want to defend themselves in a WTO dispute brought by others, we assist them. We've been involved to date in 50 WTO disputes, which is approximately 20% of all the disputes in the WTO since we were set up. The second part of our mandate is to provide legal advice to developing and least developed countries. And just this year, we provided our 2,000th legal opinion to developing countries. So each year we provide now about 200 legal opinions on various issues of WTO law to developing countries. And this is really where we replicate the kinds of in-house legal advice that the legal staff of the European Commission or the USTR that I mentioned earlier provide to their clients in the US or EU governments. We act in effect as in-house lawyers, sometimes at a distance because we're in Geneva, so not literally in-house, for developing countries. But our members and the LDCs entitled to our services can come to us on a daily basis, email us, call us, and ask us for legal advice, which may be very complicated. It might be a 100-page memo that we provide, or it could be fairly straightforward. It could be a 2-page email that we provide on a wide variety of issues of WTO law. And I'll provide a couple of examples in a moment. The third service we provide is training. We run training courses in Geneva, mostly for delegates of developing and least developed countries. We don't really have budget, at least on our own, to go to capitals and provide training directly in capitals, unless it's jointly with a partner. But we do provide increasingly training by video conference to officials in capitals. And we also have the secondment program in which Marianne has participated that she'll discuss later. There are four key principles underlining how the ACWL works. The first is that I mentioned earlier that we're independent. We're not part of the WTO. We're not answerable or controlled by any of our member governments. As you can imagine, it's important that we be independent of donor developed governments so that we're not seen to be, our legal advice is not in any way conditioned by their influence. But also with 74 countries entitled to our services, those 74 countries don't see eye to eye on a lot of issues. So it's also important that we be independent from influence by any of our developing members so that the advice we provide is independent. It's also impartial. We don't take positions on issues of our own. We're not for or against agriculture subsidies or any other issue that comes up in the WTO. Also, we respond only to requests for legal advice. We don't go out looking for problems. So if I was to read in the newspaper here tomorrow morning that Uganda had banned imports of a certain coffee from Kenya, I could not go around to Marianne's office tomorrow and say, we'll help you fight this. Why? Because Uganda is also entitled to our services, and I can't prefer Kenya over Uganda. So we have to wait for either the government of Kenya or the government of Uganda to decide that they want our help with this problem, and then when they come to us, we can help them with it. The third part of our key principle of our mandate is that our advice is strictly limited to legal advice. We don't give political advice or negotiating advice. This flows in part out of the requirement that we be impartial. So we can What does that mean in practice? It means, for example, yesterday evening I got an email from the convention center with somebody emailing me a text that had been proposed in the negotiations yesterday, and they asked me whether this was in a legally correct format, so I could make some technical suggestions on changing the legal text to make it in a better legal format, but I'm not allowed to give advice as to whether it's a good idea or a bad idea to have this particular provision in the agreement. There are plenty of others out there giving that kind of political advice. And it's been very important to our success that our mandate is limited to legal advice like that, because again, it builds trust in the governments that are using us that we are providing strictly technical legal advice, not conditioned by political positions. The final principle underlying our operations is that of confidentiality. All of our legal advice is strictly confidential. So I'll, and my colleagues on the panel will be discussing in general terms our work. We can provide some examples, but we never reveal who came to us for legal advice on what particular issue. Of course, the governments themselves can discuss it, but we can't. Now that may make us sound a little boring, but in fact we are a little boring. We're lawyers stuck in offices doing very technical work on interpreting the WTO legal agreements, which, as I said, were getting increasingly more complicated as every panel and appellate body report comes out. It's increasingly difficult even for those of us that are doing it full time to keep up. We currently have 10 lawyers working full time in Geneva, plus 4 lawyers participating each year in the program Marianne took part in, and an administrative staff of 3 people. So we have a total staff of less than 20 people, which I think makes us the smallest international organization in Geneva, and hopefully one of the most efficient. We're currently working on 9 WTO disputes, which I think is probably more than any private law firm. Maybe 1 or 2 of private law firms in the area are working on that many disputes. So why do countries consider it important, first of all, to have this kind of service available, and secondly, to use it? And my colleagues will probably expand on this in their remarks, but I would just, before turning it over to them, I would give a couple of comments. First of all, hopefully, of course, anyone that comes to us is highly confident that they're getting very good quality, independent, impartial, and technical legal advice, so that at least they understand the legal aspects of what's going on in the WTO. Secondly, our experience is that the countries that do come to us have decided that this is a very important element in enabling them to fully understand what's going on in the WTO legal system and take advantage both of their rights under the WTO agreements, but also of being fully able to defend their interests when those interests may be challenged by others. So it's important to have a good understanding of the legal basis of others' concerns before you decide on a political strategy for responding to those. A couple of examples would be, we advise developing and least developing countries on the legal aspects of accession to the WTO. So if they're being asked as part of their accession process to do something before deciding whether to agree to it or not, they need to know whether there's a good legal basis in WTO law for what they're being asked to do. Another example would be trade policy reviews, where other members may ask a country a variety of questions about their trade policies and may question specific measures or trade policies. In those cases, we provide legal advice on whether the other country's complaints are properly founded and how best to respond to them. So generally speaking, And even where developing countries are not directly involved in WTO formal dispute settlement proceedings, our experience is the countries that come to us have decided that it's very important that they have a full understanding of the legal aspects of what's going on in the WTO in order to defend their interests and before deciding what other courses of action to take. And that's what we're there to do. And so that's just a brief introduction to who we are, how these legal issues come up, and how we assist developing countries in responding to them. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to my colleague Jan Bohannes, who's going to give a sort of an overview of how it is that developing countries have participated in the more formal dispute settlement proceedings. Jan?
Can everybody hear me? Good morning. So I'm going to expand on an aspect of our activities that Niall has described, and that is assisting our members and LDCs with WTO dispute settlement. So what I'm going to do is say a few words about the system at large, provide you with some statistics, and then see how developing country participation fits into that. Now, broadly speaking, the WTO dispute settlement system is the most successful government-to-government dispute settlement system. The most active one, the most binding one, the most successful one. It recently celebrated 500 cases since 1995. That's a very impressive number if you compare it, for instance, to the International Court of Justice. It's about three times the number, more than three times the number of cases that have been brought before the ICJ since 1945. So the WTO has had many more cases in the last 20 years than the ICJ has had in 70 years. So it's a very frequently used system, members trust it. But there is often the concern that developing countries don't fully participate in this. The developing countries are not as active as they could be or as they should be, and that if you look at the list of countries who participate, developing countries, especially the small developing countries and LDCs, are not part of the mix. And some people take it to mean that the system is somehow skewed or not responsive to developing country concerns. Now, that is an incorrect perception. Developing countries do participate, not only the large ones, not only the Indias and Chinas and Mexicos and Brazils of this world, but also medium-sized and small developing countries. They participate very successfully, use it strategically. In fact, as we're going to see, some of those medium-sized and small developing countries have brought more disputes than some developed countries. I'm going to tell you the numbers in a second. And we at the center are very pleased and proud to have been involved with some of our members in precisely bringing those cases and litigating those cases. So what are some of the numbers? Let's look at the numbers. I've already mentioned there have been 501, actually now we have 501 disputes in the WTO brought since 1995. That's the dispute settlement number. So every dispute gets a number in the WTO, and if you count those numbers, you get 501 right now. In fact, if you break it down into bilateral pairings, so one complainant, one defendant, it's actually 526. So the official number understates the number of disputes. Now, how have developing countries as a group participated in these 526 disputes? Well, 42% of the cases, a developing country has been a complainant, 42%. So that's a very, very significant portion. Shows us that developing countries as a group are very active in bringing cases, being a complainant, suing other governments over market access or any other aspect of WTO law. Now, in 41% of those 526 disputes, a developing country has been a defendant. So you have almost perfect symmetry between developing countries being complainants and being defendants, roughly 40%. Now, often when people think about developing country participating in the system, they think of them as being complainants. They should be suing other people about, you know, getting access to the markets. But in fact, being a defendant is just as important being part of the system. When you are active on the complainant side, you're also, you get sued. And in fact, being a defendant is very often good from a policy perspective, because losing a case in the WTO means you are, as a government, you're able to stare down domestic interest groups who are pushing you to adopt protectionist measures. So being a defendant can actually be very good from a good governance perspective. It empowers the government to get rid of bad policies at home. Now, if we take this 40%, some say, well, that's for the developing countries as one big group. This concerns only the larger developing countries. But the smaller, the medium-sized and the smaller developing countries don't properly participate. LDCs don't participate. So that means the system is somehow skewed. 40%, all nice, but who is in those 40%? Now, what's your response to that? Well, first of all, again, from a systemic perspective, it's true that some countries participate more actively than others. But that is true for both developed and developing countries, for wealthy and less wealthy countries. The dividing line doesn't really run so much between developed, developing, or wealthy and less wealthy countries. For instance, if you look at countries like Iceland, Israel, or very wealthy Persian Gulf countries, they have never brought a dispute, never brought a dispute in the WTO. In contrast, Guatemala, who is one of our members, has brought 9 disputes. Very, very active complainant. Developed countries such as Switzerland and Norway have brought only 4 cases each, so less than Guatemala. Economic size makes participation more likely, and that's a very important aspect that sometimes gets forgotten. The bigger you are as an economy, whether developed or developing, the more you trade with more countries and more goods, and there's more opportunity to getting involved in a trade dispute. And again, that's true for both developed and developing countries. Now, if we look at the top 20 complainants, if we draw up a list and look at who's been the most frequent complainant, and you take the top 20 complainants, whom do we find in this group? Well, at the very top, you find the United States and the EU, as you would presumably expect. You would expect them to be at the top. They have each brought about 100 disputes. So together, they account for about 40% of the total disputes that have been brought. If you then look further down in the list, you find other developed and large developing countries, again, as you would expect. You would find China, you would find India, Brazil, Mexico, Argentina. But, and crucially importantly, you find a number of medium-sized and small developing countries such as Thailand, Honduras, Guatemala, Philippines, Panama, Costa Rica. And you do not find a number of developed countries. For instance, you don't find Switzerland or Norway in the top 20 list. What's also very interesting is when you look at the countries that are actually in those top 20, you see, for instance, Thailand, Honduras, or Guatemala with the same number or more disputes than Australia and New Zealand. Australia and New Zealand, very active members in the system at large with very sophisticated bureaucracies. Well, Thailand, Honduras, and Guatemala have brought more cases than Australia and New Zealand. So we see that medium-sized and small developing countries are more active than some developed countries. So these countries have made frequent use of the system to further their strategic interests, and we at the center, we have worked with these governments precisely in bringing those disputes. Another very interesting point is if we look at these 526 disputes, let's go back to the big universe, 526 disputes, who is suing whom? It's a very interesting question. In about one-third of those disputes, you get a developed country suing a developed country, about one-third. Then in about one-quarter, in 25% of the disputes, you see a developing country suing a developed country. And in the same number, 25%, you find a developed country suing a developing country. So one-third and then 25% each. Now, that means that about 17%, so almost 20% of all the disputes are between developing countries, bringing cases against each other. And what's very interesting about this particular category is that this category has grown over the years. If you look at the first 5-6 years of the system, so from 1995 to say about 2002, to the point in time where the center was created, the category of developing versus developing was about only 8%. So this percentage has doubled over the years. The more and more developing countries making use of the dispute settlement system against each other, both the large ones and the small ones, getting rid of market access barriers in developing country markets. And we see this in our work at the center, or we see this shift, sort of this growth in this category. Niall mentioned that we have 9 disputes now, that we're working on 9 disputes at the center. Well, in all but two of those disputes, it's a developing country against a developing country. So we sort of, we see this trend in our, reflected in our work. What's the subject matter of the disputes that have been brought over the years? Well, it's a broad range of topics. WTO law is a broad area of different rules and agreements. Almost all of the WTO agreements by now have been subject to at least some cases. And we could spend a long time discussing this portfolio. But what we can certainly say, there's an increasing share of regulatory issues behind the border issues, disputes, for instance, under the agreement on technical barriers to trade. But a very interesting aspect here is that about a very important share, certainly more than one third, perhaps up to 40% of all the WTO disputes that are being brought are on trade remedies, anti-dumping measures, countervailing duties, safeguards. And this fact might explain to a certain extent why some very small developing countries and LDCs have participated less or have not participated. It's because they don't operate these systems, they don't impose these anti-dumping, countervailing duties and safeguard measures, and frequently they're not subject to them either when another jurisdiction imposes these measures, because they don't produce the products that are most typically subject to anti-dumping duties, or because they are exempt under certain special and differential treatment provisions. Finally, what else can we say about the system and about developing countries? Well, system functions is functioning very well. We have a high implementation rate. Estimates vary. You get different assessments in academic writing. But basically, the compliance rate is very, very high. You find some estimates of 85% or more in all those disputes. The losing defendant implements and changes the measure that is being challenged. Members implement because they have an interest in keeping the system going. And finally, it is often said that developing countries are at a disadvantage because of their lack of retaliatory power. The WTO system envisages if a defendant doesn't comply that the complainant can impose retaliatory duties to create the political pressure on the non-complying defendant. And some say, well, that puts at a disadvantage smaller economies and developing countries in particular. Now, it's the impact or the significance of retaliation for the functioning of the system is very likely vastly overstated. Much could be said about that, but certainly in our experience at the center, retaliatory power and concerns about retaliation play a very limited to no role in a decision to initiate a dispute. And also many observers would probably agree that the decision of the losing party whether to implement a WTO judgment or not will not typically, in most cases, be driven by concerns about retaliation, rather about domestic concerns, domestic interest groups, power constellation, and other factors unrelated to retaliation. So in sum, the system is not perfect. Members in the WTO are discussing how to reform the system, how to make tweaks to the system, but it certainly has been, if we look back at the last 20 years, it's been more successful and more active than anybody anticipated. It does remain the most active and successful government-to-government dispute settlement system, and it does work well, and it has worked well for those developing countries, even the medium-sized and small ones that have chosen to use it strategically. And we're very pleased and proud at the center to have worked with those members, both on the complainant and defendant side, and we look forward to continuing that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jan. I think we'll wait till the end of the four speakers to take any questions you may have, if that's okay. And so with that, I would turn it over to Ryan.
Hello. Thank you, Niall. And good morning, everyone. I'd like to greet you with some of the words that I have learned in the past few days. Jambo, umeyayam kaje habariyako. So, thank you. Good morning. It's a pleasure to be in Kenya. My name is Ryan, as Niall mentioned. I am from Manila, the capital of the beautiful islands of the Philippines. I know that Kenya has more than 10 islands off the Indian Ocean coast, which I read were very beautiful natural locations with many historical landmarks and exotic plants and animals. We in the Philippines, we also have a few islands, 7,107 to be more specific. Although some say that this is just during high tide, so if it's during low tide, we have more than 7,107 islands. We are separated by 9,400 kilometers, one oceans and four seas. But I guess we have many things in common. We have the same warm hospitality and welcome smiles that we have seen from the Kenyans everywhere we go. So in the Philippines, we say mabuhay. Here you say karibu. We also share the same patience and long suffering, especially during heavy traffic. But I think you are more patient than us, as I rarely hear Kenyans blow their car horns. And this morning I came from the hotel. I was waiting for a shuttle to bring me to the KICC and to here. The kind lady said it will take me about 5 minutes to get the shuttle. So I look at my watch, it was about 30 minutes already. And so I learned that 5 minutes, like in Manila, when you say 5 minutes, it could be an hour or 2 hours. So I laud you for your patience, and it's a good experience for me. So for the past five years, I've been based in the Philippine Mission in Geneva. My ambassador had wanted to come here to spread the good news about ACWL and show our appreciation for the great work that Niall, Jan, and their team has done for developing countries like the Philippines. Unfortunately, he's now negotiating a Nairobi package in the KICC, and we're hoping for the best. As for disputes, the Philippines has been a complainant in 5 cases and a respondent in 6 cases and a third party in 14 disputes. I have been personally involved in about 9 disputes. And as Niall mentioned a while ago, one of our disputes is where they were our counsel against the US and the EU when they filed against a case against us on our distilled spirits tax regime. The ACWL has also been on the other side of the fence, so to speak. When they defended Thailand, when we filed a case against them on their cigarettes customs valuation regime. Okay, so like Kenya, the Philippines is an original member of the ACWL, having joined in 1999. Today, I would just like to briefly share with you 3 points. Based on our experience, which illustrates the benefits that WTO developing country members, including LDCs, can get from the ACWL. So firstly, I think that the ACWL is like a family member or a close friend that you can always count on, even if you don't reciprocate their kindness. Now, you remember your mom, no? Gives you allowance every day, but you don't follow her instructions. So after giving a relatively small voluntary contribution upon joining the ACWL, the Philippines has reaped many benefits. If you make a simple cost-benefit analysis, it would show that the benefits would outweigh the costs perhaps more than 10 times. And since we're not contributing anything anymore, we'll be getting more benefits in the coming years. So that would be in our favor. So also like a relative or true friend, the ACWL is also a confidant whom you can trust with your innermost thoughts and concerns, as it fiercely upholds its independence and the confidentiality of their dealings with client members. Most of the services they provide are pro bono or gratis, and the professional fees they charge for representation in disputes are very reasonable compared to the market rate in Geneva. Secondly, the ACWL is like your favorite cool teacher who treats you kindly and imparts lasting knowledge. So Niall here, Jan, and very competent legal experts at the WTO take time each week to teach courses on WTO law to Geneva-based delegates. They are my favorite professors because they give us free lunch every week prior to the class. So this week it will be sandwiches and soup. Next week it will be Chinese food. And more importantly, they don't force us to take the exam. So you can opt not to take the exam at the end of the course. But more seriously, they teach 3 courses. The first one is about basic knowledge of WTO. The second one deals with the details of WTO agreements. And the last one is on the nuances of the dispute settlement mechanism. From the Philippine Mission, we have had 6 delegates take advantage of these courses in the past 3 years. They are so helpful that even our ambassador, who was already an expert on WTO matters, has attended these classes and has learned a lot from our lecturers. The ACWL also trains capital-based lawyers through a 9-month secondment program in its office in Geneva, as Niall mentioned. Mary Ann here is a living testament of the value of the program to governments in building their capacity to engage more proactively in the rules-based multilateral trading system. Back in 2011, the Philippines also benefited from the secondment of one of our lawyers from the Office of the Solicitor General. And after the program, he helped represent the Philippines in two of our disputes. So currently, we have a young lady lawyer, also from the same office, who is seconded at the ACWL until the middle of next year. As Niall mentioned, I understand they also provide training through video conferencing, which would greatly benefit those that could not otherwise come to Geneva. And finally, my last point is that the ACWL is a very wise advisor. If you watch Star Wars, they could be Yoda. And the ACWL is a formidable defender of our rights. The WTO is a rules-based organization monitoring members' compliance with its commitments and obligations and the resolution of alleged non-compliance through its dispute settlement mechanism. There is simply no other organization like the ACWL that has expertise in WTO law and shares it freely with developing countries. In our day-to-day operations in the missions, for instance, we get questions from Manila on whether certain measures in force or about to be undertaken are consistent with WTO rules. We are also asked about whether certain legislative bills or regulations in other countries abide by WTO law. These requests come from government agencies, business entities, and other actors. Upon request, the ACWL provides timely legal opinion on these matters, which helps our government act proactively in capital and in articulating our concerns in Geneva. Compliance with WTO rules also takes the shape of ensuring that even when the regulations and measures we have taken seem contrary to multilateral rules, we can still avail of flexibilities and preferences allowed by the system. ACWL can provide legal advice on exceptions, waivers, transitional periods, and special and differential treatment provisions that may address particular sensitivities in the domestic market. The ACWL also provides legal representation to its members in disputes in order to protect their rights. Filing a dispute is normally the court of last resort, and alternative avenues such as consultations and bilateral meetings are first exhausted to resolve differences. When the issues prove intractable, the ACWL is prepared to represent its members before the panel and appellate body in a competent manner, usually beyond the capabilities of developing countries. For the Philippines, for instance, there have been two appellate body members and six panelists which have served in their personal capacity in the appellate body as well as in these different panels. Yet, we still need help as we do not have a dedicated office and expertise for WTO law. In fact, on WTO matters in general, it is challenging to cover and master a wide range of regular and negotiating bodies. This is even more difficult dealing with the legal aspect, which is highly technical and requires experienced professionals that have dealt with many of these disputes and know how to situate newer rulings in the broader jurisprudence. When the measures are determined to be contrary to WTO rules by the dispute settlement body through the recommendations and rulings of a panel and the appellate body, the ACWL also assists in ensuring our compliance with the ruling. For instance, the ACWL valiantly defended our position in a case filed by the US and the EU on our tax regime in distilled spirits. Though the decision was unfavorable to us, we were able to secure a reasonable period of time to implement it, and the ACWL assisted us in facilitating the necessary legislative amendments back home. So inclusive growth has been a buzzword in the development agendas of developing countries, perhaps like Kenya and the Philippines. In the WTO, which is a member-driven organization, inclusive participation is only possible if members understand the highly technical and legal structure, the principles and rules of the organization. The ACWL provides members with the necessary training, advice, and representation that enables members not only to abide by WTO rules, but also to protect and promote their rights in an inclusive manner. In closing, I had observed earlier that Kenyans and Africans in general, like Filipinos, are very patient, and I suspect you do not like filing cases in court. Yet it is important that you protect your rights and ensure compliance with obligations in a preventive manner. If that is not possible, you would need the expertise of people willing to help you battle, as David had against Goliath, bigger powers that have their own dedicated lawyers and deep resources in dispute settlement proceedings. So The message is ACWL is here to help, and as attested by our own experience, ACWL can be your mother, can be your friend, your teacher, your mentor, and your defender. So thank you very much. Asante and Habaria Suburi.
Thank you, Ryan. That's a huge responsibility you've placed on us to play all of those roles, which, some of which I think I'm definitely not qualified for, especially the mothering. Anyway, with that, we'll turn over to Mary Ann to say a few words. Thank you.
Thank you, Nell. My name is Mary Ann Masheru. I work as a senior state counsel at the Office of the Attorney General. And my main responsibilities entails giving legal advice to the government ministries in regard to legal issues, emerging legal issues, but more specifically now on international trade law. So I was seconded to ACWL for the secondment program in the year 2013-2014. And after the program, I came back to serve the government in the capacity of as a senior counsel. So just like many developing countries and least developed countries, Kenya's Ministry of International Trade, Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Trade, lacks legal expertise in international trade law matters. And as such, the ministry relies heavily on the Office of the Attorney General for legal advice and legal interpretation. And in turn, the Office of the Attorney General also lacks legal expertise, especially with regard to matters of international trade law. So in that recognition, the Office of the Attorney General deemed it fit to nominate me for the secondment program so that I can have a deeper understanding on the WTO law. Whenever my colleagues ask me about my experience at the ACWL, I always tell them it was an invaluable experience. And it's truly an invaluable experience, and I know these are facts that can be attested by many lawyers who have gone through the secondment program. It's quite invaluable in that throughout the program, I was able to get a deeper understanding of the WTO law. I was able to have an in-depth interpretation of the WTO law because they take you through a very rigorous training. You undertake research. You are able to do analysis of the appellate body decisions and the panel body reports. So as such, once a lawyer goes through the secondment program, you have a deeper understanding of the WTO law. As a secondment lawyer, you work under the guidance of a very dedicated team, as you can see here, and they are always very ready to give guidance and stewardship towards interpretation and understanding of the WTO law. During my program, I realized that interpretation of the WTO law is a challenge, especially for most developing countries and LDCs that don't have legal expertise within their ministries or within their offices of the Attorney General. And as such, this has been a great hindrance for most countries, even towards bringing disputes against other countries at the WTO law. So interpretation and a deeper understanding of the WTO law is very critical, and that's why the role of the ACWL is very critical, and I actually laud them for the work they are doing. With the exposure I gained at the WTO law, I can now confidently give legal advice to the government, and I also know that whenever I have limitations, I can always call on the ACWL to help me give legal advice, and they always come in very handy. They are very they're very quick to give a response, and even the process is not as tedious. It's just a matter of giving an email to Nile, and within 2-3 days you have your response. So as Ryan said, ACWA is a very dependable organization, and the secondment program is a key component for building capacity, especially for developing countries and LDCs for the legal expertise. So as such, I would say that the program is very keen in enhancing legal expertise in international trade law, and I would greatly advise and encourage all of you to nominate your lawyers to the ACWL secondment program. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Marianne. And those are our four presentations, but which hopefully haven't been talking about ourselves too much. But I'm not sure what sort of backgrounds of people we have here, but I'd very much welcome any questions you may have and any thoughts you may have about how law fits in the WTO system and how it affects your countries as members of the WTO. And also, another point I'm interested in also is how WTO obligations serve to impact on governance in developing countries, in all countries, but also in developing countries, because a lot of WTO obligations have, for want of a better word, good governance or rule of law aspects. You know, for example, some of the provisions of the GATT or the Trade Facilitation Agreement contain a lot of transparency and predictability requirements that have effects on governance. And one thing that, as a lawyer, is of interest to me is how these whether these obligations are seen and are used by developing countries as opportunities to improve governance and legal systems domestically. So with that, please. Questions? I think we have all. Oops. We'll start from the front and work back. So, Madam.
Thank you. Elizabeth Bachivinga Gaswaga, legal advisor with the Rule of Law, Commonwealth Secretariat. My question addresses capacity, and it's addressed to all the members of the panel. Looking at Goal 16, of the SDGs, what would SCWL consider training non-governmental, non-profit lawyers to ensure that there is more capacity? Would the center consider training non-government, non-profit lawyers? And secondly, is it possible to have a training of trainers program to help trickle down WTO laws to the developing countries? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much, the panelists. My question is related to what is just asked, and I wanted to direct it to Marianne, because she happens to come from the same country where I come. And I wanted to find out, it's still on capacity building and related to the training of trainers. I wanted to find out, what is the AG's office doing, particularly in this regard, given that you have already been trained on WTO law. Does the AG's office have in plan something like you training other lawyers on WTO laws, other than having to go to ACWL, or what mechanisms are you proposing for Kenyan lawyers to have access to ACWL in terms of building their capacity? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm Joel Obengo. I happen to come from Kenyatta University. I have a question which will be directed to Marianne. I'm also a Kenyan. I wanted to know, I'm very much aware that President Kenyatta's administration is vigorously and aggressively pursuing the issue of economic diplomacy as one of its major pillar in international trade. Now, in regard to this capacity building, in your own opinion, do you think this intervention is adequate, the secondment of state lawyers to ACWL? Is it an adequate measure that can address the skill gap both in the foreign ministry and the state law office? And secondly, to Mr. Ryan, I've only heard about you training lawyers, but in the whole architecture of trade negotiations, we really don't have lawyers. I don't think whether they are all lawyers. We have diplomats, we have trade negotiators, and so forth and so forth. Do you also extend this similar training to such kind of people? Thank you.
Yes, morning. My name is Kefas Chakoti. I come from the Trade Policy Training Center in Africa, based in Arusha. We're listening to actually all the speakers. Of course, one observation that I picked from Jan is he brought the statistics in terms of participation and the work that ACWL has been doing, which is actually quite great. I seriously comment on it. But I was also waiting to see the breakdown on the statistics regarding the participation of the African countries, especially within this setup. And one thing that immediately underlies that has so much to do with what has now been voiced, capacity for them to internalize the issues that would eventually translate into even generating a case, even identifying whether there's a case, and taking that forward. Obviously, it touches on also what my previous speakers have said. It's not just the lawyers. We also have individuals who have to have the competence to understand the trade issues, be they economists, be they political scientists, or from the private sector, civil society, and stuff like that, all coming together to identify these issues, eventually working with the lawyers to translate into identifying whether there's a case or whether they can actually constitute a case to take forward in the first place. So one thing, and listening to Marianne, yeah, she's been able to access that competence from SCWL. Obviously, one thing that is clear is we need a critical mass of individuals who have this conceptualization. So at the back of my mind, I was thinking, okay, would it be feasible to decentralize ACWL to these countries? Okay, of course, I'm looking at it figuratively. And I'm thinking, okay, one way that could be done is probably identifying partnership arrangements with ACWL and organizations that are involved in capacity building on trade law and the other aspects of international trade. Where I come from, basically has been providing training on trade law, trade policy, and trade facilitation since 2006. And probably I can see an opportunity where that decentralization could work through a partnership arrangement. And in that way, we'll be in a position to actually create a critical mass of individuals who can assist these countries. So that is one on capacity. Then the other one, which is just a floating idea that I was having at the back of my mind, is with the dynamics now, where we're seeing regional integration building up and shaping the interaction among actually members of the WTO, the mega regionals are coming up. Since ACWL focuses on specifically WTO law, is there a mechanism where ACWL as an institution could, in tandem with these dynamics, identify ways of supporting the needs of WTO members, but which may arise from regional arrangements? it's an idea that was floating in at the back of my mind. Thank you.
Okay, I'm Joseph. I work with an organization that champions human rights and brought away the civil society. More of my questions have been asked by my colleagues, but I just want to give a slice of the same, given that I come from an African country and from the ongoings in the other sectors of the economy. I wanted to find out this. Given that a country like Kenya, you find that business basically, because it's a fast-growing country, you find that the private sector is actually almost overdoing the government sectors in business. That's making a going out or venturing out into other countries. And you may find that maybe a company or an individual who is wealthy enough and is able to trade with other blocks, is able to move in more than maybe three blocks or maybe three countries having business. And he comes across, he makes an offense maybe to a country that is actually registered with the WTO law reinforcement, or maybe the organization that we are talking about right now. How do you go about it? Do you come? Do you advise maybe the registered member country, or against the country that the member is actually coming from? How do you venture for this person? Because previously we've been looking at in the political arena in some of our countries, you'll discover that just going and getting somebody and maybe creating some law and reinforcement becomes very hard. Because I don't know if it's unlawfulness or whatever kind of a situation that's existing in between there. Now, that I think another one is also already asked, and if that one is addressed, I'll get a picture of how we are going to undertake this. And finally, I wanted to get some idea. Now that we are really advocating on trade blocks, maybe the East African Community and the rest, are we, as the trade laws, are we growing at the same rate as much as we are educating people to, or countries to make economic blocks? Are we also going at the same rate so that we also advise them that as much as you are going for these blocks, we should also be compliant to this, given that we are going to have much of these disputes in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity to present my question. I'm Muthoka Sila from the University of Nairobi. Now, I've been following the session, and I really enjoyed it. I have a question, and it is something like a comment that I've just observed as I was following the discussion. I don't know whether ACWL has envisaged a possible dilemma situation, maybe where the two sides in a international trade dispute come to you for an advice, maybe simultaneously or one after another. Because now, eventually, when you're saying that the advice that they receive is impartial, in the end, and also remember that Neil also said that some of these countries cannot see eye to eye. Now, they come, they have a dispute, and both of them approach ACWL for advice. You will advise one country on how to get maximum benefits from this case. How will you advise the other to ensure that you are not only creating a place where we can stand in between instead of making one maximize the benefits out of international trade? Thank you. I like following the issue of institutions and trade.
Okay, thank you very much all for the first round of questions. I'll make a couple of comments on some of them before turning over to my various colleagues, and in particular rely on Marianne to answer the Kenya-specific questions. With respect to the first question on training non-government officials, our mandate is primarily to assist governments, because the governments are the actual members of the WTO. So our primary focus is on government officials, and we only go beyond that where sort of resources or partners or whatever permit us to do it. On training of trainees, I mean, that is would be a very efficient way of doing that. And so we're open to any ideas that you may have, and I would encourage you, madam, to speak to us afterwards or send me an email and continue that discussion. Likewise with TRAPCA, we've been involved in some discussions with TRAPCA on cooperating, and again, or you know, to the extent our resources permit, we would be delighted to do that. I know some of my colleagues have in the past gone to events at TRAPCA and participated. We're also participating, for example, we're one of the sponsors of the Africa round of the ELSA moot court competition for law students on WTO law. And that's something that will be taking place in South Africa, I forget which university, at the end of March or early April this year. And that's something in which we participate also. But unfortunately, we have, you know, we do have our own resource constraints that limit our ability to do a lot of the things we would really like to do. Nevertheless, we're always trying to get as involved as we can in discussions on how we can better allocate our resources and what opportunities there are out there for partnering or training trainers and ideas like this, all of which are very good ideas. The only other comment I would answer, the question I'll answer before turning over my colleagues to answer the others, is with respect to the gentleman from the University of Nairobi. What happens when two countries come to us at the same time? And we are, like other lawyers, subject to some conflict of interest rules. So if we do have two countries that come to us about the same dispute, we can only advise the country that comes to us first. So if we do have two of our members that come to us on a dispute, we can only advise the one that comes to us first. But what happens then, the country that comes to us second, because they are too a country that's entitled to our services as a member. And what we've done in those situations is we've gotten the cooperation of several private law firms in the area who have agreed in those cases to provide the legal advice to the second country on the same terms that we would, so that the second country that comes to us can get the help of a law firm and doesn't have to pay any more or anything different than if they had been the country that came to us first. And that's happened, as Jan mentioned, there are increasingly disputes between developing countries, so that's something that comes up more and more frequently. The other aspect of that we're studying is, as we get a little bit bigger, as I said, we're now 10 lawyers, but some of our countries have asked us whether in those situations it would be possible to create what's called a Chinese wall in the office so that we could directly help both countries and just have two separate teams that never talk to each other about the dispute. So we're looking into the practicalities of that. And of course, in a given situation, that would be something that could only be done with the express consent of both countries. The other issue that's been raised is that we could provide a joint legal opinion to the two countries. So we would, in a way, act as sort of legal mediators in a dispute like that. Because that's something actually that's happened informally in the past, where a country comes to us for a legal opinion about a measure of another country. We give them the legal opinion, and then they share it with the other country. And the two countries have resolved the issue between themselves on the basis of our legal advice. So some of our members have asked us to look into whether we could provide on a more regular basis joint legal opinions and sort of act in a way as a provider of mediation or good office services in those kinds of situations. So that's something we're looking into, and again, we'd have to get the approval of our members to do something like that. Okay, well, and one last point is about the issue about advising on mega regionals, and that's something we're already doing. I mean, our mandate is focused on WTO law, but the mega regionals all still, and other regional trade agreements, all still operate under the umbrella, the shadow of the WTO. So we frequently get questions, including from African countries and the various regional agreements, on how do these affect what's still the overriding obligations of WTO law. Now, probably as if the dispute settlement provisions of the mega regionals start to be mobilized more and more, then we may have to look at how that affects our mandate. But for the time being, we're well able to and do quite a bit of advising on the mega regionals. And I recall I met with some of the ECOWAS members yesterday, and they noted that under ECOWAS, the default dispute settlement mechanism is still the WTO mechanism. So it remains to be seen how much or how quickly the regional dispute settlement mechanisms will evolve to be a real sort of practical or well-used alternative to WTO. With that, maybe I'll just turn over to my colleagues and ask them each to respond to the questions in turn, and then hopefully we may have time for one more round of questions before wrapping up. Thank you. Jan?
Sure. I think Niall has answered all the questions that as the ACWL can answer. I just wanted to add one more thing. The gentleman from Arusha asked about the capacity issues, sort of the ability to identify trade issues or potential trade concerns that could lead to a dispute. Now, as Niall was saying during his initial remarks, our mandate does not allow us to go and actively seek out disputes to tell governments that there might be an issue out there with another export market and they could consider bringing a case. That's something we're not allowed to do because our mandate doesn't allow that. We wait until the government approaches us with what they consider to be a potential issue, and then we can assess the legal merits of that case. But of course, you're absolutely right that it's sort of in that run-up before a government comes to us, there is a lot that can happen and must happen on the domestic governance side. And if you look at the very active users of the system and at the less active users of the system, you will see that one thing that tends to divide them is the way in which the government interacts with private industry, because of course it is the private industry that trades. They are the ones who trade, and the most diligent and the best informed government official will not be aware of all the potential trade issues out there. The industry knows, and so it's absolutely fundamental for a government to foster the cooperation and interaction with the industry. But of course, there's also the aspect of how the government bureaucracy is organized, whether you have one agency that takes care of trade issues where the industry can then go to. Those are all things that obviously are not part of our mandate, and they fall within that's a very fundamental aspect of how government organizes itself and how governance is organized at the national level. There are, I understand that, for instance, ICTSD has some training programs where they communicate with governments about sharing the experiences of the more active users of the system with those who are less active and who, say, wish to see how other members have gone about organizing themselves in this regard. But that's something we don't do. That's not part of our mandate. But it's a very important aspect, as you rightly point out.
Ryan?
Yep. Thank you, Niall. There was one question addressed to me by the gentleman in front. And just trivia, if to share with you, Director General Roberto Acevedo is a trained engineer and diplomat. He's not actually a lawyer, but I think maybe you guys know he headed the dispute team of Brazil, I think back in the 90s, and he's been legendary for having won many cases. I don't know if he lost the case, but he's not a lawyer. So it's possible to train diplomats, economists to be good at WTO law. And that is why in our mission, most of us are not lawyers in the mission, but we have benefited from the training given by ACWL. These courses have been helpful to us in our daily work at the mission, attending the meetings and getting the questions from Manila, as I mentioned a while ago. And you did mention that negotiations are undertaken by mostly diplomats, trade experts. And in fact, these agreements, when they ever come to an agreement, are not perfect. There is a political aspect. There's horse trading to it. And my ambassador is the head of the chairman of the Preparatory Committee on Trade Facilitation. So when they agreed on the TFA in Bali, after that, they underwent a legal scrubbing of the text to make sure that the agreement would be consistent with the current WTO rules. So in that aspect, you could see that there are dynamics in negotiations where you would need legal experts to deal with these agreements after the fact and also before the fact. No? As Niall mentioned a while ago, there are ongoing negotiations at the KICC. And at one point or another, some delegations may want to get in touch with Niall and Jan to check whether the agreements are in the legal form that is expected of these agreements. And by the way, we might need your help the next couple of days. I hope you'd be available to help us with certain options we were thinking about. So thank you.
And thanks. Before turning over to Marianne, Ryan's reference to Director General Acevedo's experience in dispute settlement reminds me of a conversation I had with him once in the late 90s. I was working in a law firm and we worked with Brazil and with Director General Acevedo, who was heading the Brazilian government team in the dispute, on a dispute. There were disputes between Brazil and Canada over subsidies to aircraft manufacturers of these regional jets. And as Ryan said, the Director General was doing an excellent job. Even though he's not a lawyer, he's a mechanical engineer by training. He was really doing an excellent job on the legal aspects of the case and had a very good grasp of the legal issues. And we were talking about this one evening, and he said to me, "Niall, for an engineer, it's very easy to learn how to do a lawyer's job, but no lawyer could ever learn how to do an engineer's job." So it was a fairly humbling comment, and I think it's true. Nobody should ever ask me on any help with any engineering issues. With that, I'll turn over to Marianne.
Thanks, Niall. I'll address a question that was asked about what the AG's office is doing to address the gaps in the skills with the regard to international trade law. So one of the things that the AG's office has done, we have created a division of international law division within the Office of the Attorney General, and it has a section that specifically deals with the WTO law and international trade. So we have a section of councils that are basically just doing WTO law and international trade. And with that, we are building expertise, we are training them. And that has really helped, because especially when you get councils who are just focusing on international trade law, you are able to even get trainings. And we've also been engaging the Directorate of International Trade, so that whenever they are going for negotiations, whenever they are going to do anything with the WTO law, they are always engaging us. So to that extent, the division has been able to create expertise. And on another issue, we also encourage what I would say like the trainers of trainers, so that if when I went to the ACWL, I came back and I was able to pass on the knowledge that I gained from the ACWL. So I would normally take my colleagues through the trainings, and with that we are able to build capacity within the office. The another aspect that the office has also been able to do, we've also created a roster of external lawyers that are maybe possibly in the private sector that have expertise in international trade. And whenever we feel we have limitation in terms of getting legal advice within the government on international trade lawyers, we would always call on the expertise of the private lawyers. So the liaison also between the government advocates and the advocates within the private sector has also helped in creating expertise within the government. The other question that was asked was on how to address whether I feel the intervention by ACWL is adequate to address the skill gap. I think you will realize that ACWL can only do so much. It can only train so many lawyers. And as Niall and Jan have said, they train a maximum of 4 lawyers within 1 year. So to that extent, the government has so much to do. The greater responsibility lies with the government to train the lawyers, to also give scholarships. And there are also other bodies within the region. We've been lucky enough to have TRAPCA. They have really quite assisted in training in international trade law. We also have TRALAC that is based in South Africa. They do so much with regard to training of WTO law. So there are also scholarship. I've also been a beneficiary of a scholarship at the South African Institute at the University of Western Cape. It has a component. It's a master's program on international trade law, WTO law, and they get expertise from WTO and other organizations that they have mandate on international trade law. So the government has a huge responsibility in ensuring that the lawyers within the ministries are well trained. So that's what I would say. Thank you.
Thank you, Marianne. I hope everyone felt their questions were answered. If there were aspects of the questions that you feel weren't answered, we'll have, I think, another round of questions, and please restate them. Also, we'd be very interested in any comments anyone have. It doesn't have to be questions, but comments about what your perceptions of the role of WTO law in interacting with issues such as economic justice and human rights. And even though our day-to-day work is not directly in those fields, we're very interested, professionally and intellectually in seeing how our work impacts on areas such as human rights and economic justice law, and what the interaction is. And I'm being told we have a few minutes to wrap up, so we'll have one more round of questions or comments if there are any. Before doing that, I would just like to mention we have some colleagues in the room from Chinese Taipei. And Chinese Taipei is a member of the ACWL, a developing country member of the ACWL, and a user of our services. But also, more importantly, they're also a very strong supporter of our services to other developing and least developed countries, including the African countries, recognizing the importance of the things we've discussed today and the role played by the ACWL in facilitating developing and least developed country participation in the WTO. And I'm very happy to inform you, and I'm very grateful for the fact that Chinese Taipei has recently announced an additional contribution of $100,000 to fund the operations of the ACWL. So since we have colleagues in the room, I'd like to express appreciation for that. Thank you. And okay, so any other questions or comments before we close the session? Yes, we have.
Thank you. My name is Kasim. I work with the International Growth Center, London School of Economics. And I missed, most of the talk, but I have one pressing issue concerning the work of WTO. So there is a very big problem sometimes with intellectual property rights and the patents that WTO supports. When it comes to important products like HIV drugs, sometimes there are stockouts and the law does not is not flexible enough to allow the developing countries to produce some of those important drugs. So I don't know why it should be like that, or whether there is some way to make some of those patents flexible in such challenging situations. Thank you.
Any other questions, or will we just respond to that one? Okay, yeah. Jan will respond to that one.
Thank you. It's a very interesting question, very interesting topic, one that has been very much debated at the WTO and in academic writing. We could say a lot about this, but in principle, yes, you're right, WTO members are obliged by virtue of the TRIPS agreement to provide patents. And that obviously also includes patents for medicines. On the other hand, there is flexibility in the TRIPS agreement for compulsory licensing. Under the TRIPS agreement, so a government can grant compulsory licenses in situations where it feels that this is warranted, also from a perspective of public health, and HIV would be a prime example of that. On top of it, as you, as probably most people here are aware, there is an additional mechanism that members negotiated in the WTO a few years ago that allows governments to provide compulsory licenses for export of medicines to other markets. And that mechanism exists. There's a wealth of information on the WTO website about it. Hasn't been much used. I believe there's one case involving Canada granting that license for certain medicines to be exported. I forget to which particular market. But you're right. This is a topic that has been very much live, and members have been discussing it at the WTO. It was it Rwanda? Okay, Canada for Rwanda.
Thank you. And that's precisely the kind of legal issue that developing and least developed countries in Geneva come to us for assistance on negotiating the legal aspects of those waivers, so to speak, from the TRIPS obligations. Okay, if there are no further questions or comments, I would just like to thank you all again for coming to this presentation. I hope you found it interesting. We very much appreciate your participation. For those of you that want a little bit more information, we've left some copies of our reports and brochures outside the room. And our website is www.acwl.ch. For colleagues from the Commonwealth and from TRAPCA that want to follow up on some of the ideas we discussed, if you go on our website, you'll find our email addresses, which are also in the materials. And please do follow up. You know, it's sometimes frustrating when we come to meetings like this and we have the initial part of the discussion, but not the follow-up part of the discussion. So please do get in touch, and so we can continue the discussion. So thank you once more to ICTSD for the excellent organization. Thank you for participating. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference. Thanks.